Good evening, everyone. It's been great to be in God's presence. Thank you.
nasty, not sticks and really affect the world. It's more than a love break, more than a system. We are doing it by the system. Amen. And we should be interested in continuing to do what God is doing around the world. It's just a few hours to read the living stone. So I want us to think about this for a moment. Living stone. But analogy of stone is that it's a good analogy for permanent structure. If you want to think of a very solid house, you think of a house that you build a stone or brick. The Bible says brick to make the field hard to play. So stone was much more secure than the other things out there. But there will be some time. Wood was not readily accessible, and even wood that the person wanted to stone. So, he says, you are living stones for carpenters to be built. It takes a certain very solid secure. It's what we think of doctrinal truth when we're building God's house. It can't be just a flimsy superstructure. It's got to have a strong foundation. It's got to have a strong wall that must be built on stones that will last for all the time. But it is just living not just gold, not stones, but living stones. Of course, we usually think of stones as gold, and not as gold. But thanks to the analogy of a stone that's alive. Now think, though a stone is just one of the elements of the stone, pick it up and throw it, it's got quite a force. So what if that stone were not nearly enough? What if it were just a little bit of a stone core? Could be a powerful force. So I think that when the Bible speaks of a living stone, as I said a moment ago, I think of doctrinal truth, which is solid and secure. But when I think of a living stone, I think of the security of God. Without the Spirit, the structure is just weak. Without the Spirit, the doctrine is just information. Jesus himself says, it shall not live by bread alone, it's going to be on its memory. That was every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Because my words are spirit and life. The letter kills, the scripture says, but the spirit gives life. So when I read about the church built on living stones, we add living stones. There is a firm foundation that goes, a firm structure that comes from the word of God. But there's new life and great anointing that comes from the Spirit of God. To be a well-rounded Christian and a well-rounded church, we can have both word and spirit. Maybe to be strong and secure, yet we need to be flexible and living in our lives. Praise God. Because you are willing to start to come up to a spiritual house. Think of this. A spiritual house. We are individuals. But we must be fit to fulfill our purpose in that way. So it's not just a pile of stones lying here. It's not just one stone in this place that's going to be some in that place. But every stone has its proper place. Every part of the building must fit into it. And it can't be just a little clip or a little group of like-minded people. What if you say, look, you know, I'm so shooting for the front wall, so let's just have a front wall. We don't want anything else, you know? You've got to have more than a front wall. You've got to have a side wall. You've got to have a back wall. What about the roof? You can't just say, I want to be a roof and have nothing else. You can't just have just a roof. You've got to have front wall. So my point is, each member is different. Each member has its special. Each member probably relates to certain other members of their church. Brick on the wall might look pretty much the same as that particular wall, but the building is more than that particular wall. There's got to be a lot of other structures, some hidden, some visible. There's got to be a lot of other components of the building. So to build up God's house, we need every member to be involved and connected, not just doing their own thing, not just in isolation, not just what their favorite little group that they prefer. God connects you to earth life so that together we can be the house of God. It's actually great to have a church of all ages, of all races, of all backgrounds, where they may be working clients, or they may be professionals that have different life experiences, come from different places. That's an advantage, because you want to have a diverse church that will be a strong and secure church, yet a church where anyone and everyone can be kept. If we would think we are building God's place, a spiritual place, a holy priesthood, so that he uses another illustration that we call a priesthood. In the Old Testament, the priests were certain people set apart in various ways. They offered sacrifices to God on behalf of the people. And you might think at first glance, oh, well, that's the pastor, that's the priesthood, that's the substitute. But we actually know a priesthood in the New Testament is a perfect priesthood. Because every believer is called to be set apart. Every believer is called to offer the sacrifice of praise. It's no longer just one representative. Yes, we still have our pastors and teachers who preach and teach the word of God. We still have leaders. Of course, we must have leadership. We must have a community and another analogy. We must have a shepherd. But the community of God, all the people of God are called to praise. All of us are called to praise and are called to God and pray for one another. It's great to have a pastor to pray for you, but if the pastor's not there, you can pray for yourself. You can pray for one another, because every one of us is called to be a priest of the God. Jesus Christ is the high priest, but under him, we are all priests of the God. So we all become part of the temple. We all become part of the priesthood. And we all are to offer the sacrifice. In the Old Testament, they had sacrifices of animals and of grain. But in the New Testament, the sacrifices of the Old Testament are the sacrifices of praise, the food of our lips. So we give thanks to God, we offer spiritual sacrifice, acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So when we come together on a Sunday night like this, give us thanks here for God. Each of us is different, but we really, while God loves us individually, I don't believe in that. But to really fulfill God's purpose, we must be united collectively. Our values are connected to what we're connected to the past. Just like a stone lies in the field that has some value, but most of that value is in the kingdom. Even if it's a precious stone, even if it's a diamond, lying there in the field, it doesn't really have much intrinsic value. It's only valuable when you pick it up, when you cut it, when you polish it, when you paint it. If it's a diamond, when you put it to a stone, if it's an ordinary stone, when you put it on a pit or on a lab, it's valuable multiplied. Because fulfilling its purpose is not to lie in isolation, its purpose is to be connected. So that's why we come to join them. That's why we're interested in Christian followers and establishing Christian churches. That's why we want to have Bible studies and all preaching groups. That's why we're connected to the United Pentecostal Church of Mexico. Because collectively, we can do much more than what we can do individually. We're building God's house. The vision is much greater than what we see right here. It's much greater than our own personal lives. And so when we come to worship Him, we want to be blessed. But we come to offer blessings to God. We come to offer sacrifices unto God. And we have a sense that in this service, God is going to accomplish His purpose. Someone may be healed tonight. Someone may be filled with the Holy Spirit tonight. Someone is discouraged. They need to be encouraged. Someone is confused. Or someone is seeking God's will. They need for direction. And even though I may not be that particular person, I will be blessed as they are blessed. Because if I fulfill my purpose, we're all blessed. The temple is built. It's the illustration of the Old Testament temple. When it was built and dedicated to glory of God. And it was so powerful that the priest could not even stand up to the presence of God. They could feel it. focus on yourself, you can do it. But when you focus on the Lord, and when you focus on your brothers and sisters, sometimes there is a wave of glory. Sometimes there's a presence. Sometimes you can see it moving across the world. Maybe not a visible sign, but you can see that people are being affected. It's more important. I see the wind blowing through. The grove of trees, you can see the wind passing through by the response of trees to the leaves. And so sometimes in the sanctuary, you can actually sense the presence of God as it moves across the congregation. And people individually respond. You realize it's more than just an individual response, but God is filling his house. God is filling his temple. We together are filling a house where the presence of God can dwell. Praise God! Building God's house. That's why it's good to get reports from the rest of the world around the country from other churches in the same city or the same state because we're building this house together. Praise God! I try to share that in testimonies from wherever I come in. And then one wonderful thing that God's doing, we've been working for a number of years with Wesley College Church and graduate students. Every year, we contribute only $1 million to the church. That's a good goal for the Lord Church. One fourth to the children's ministry, one fourth to the graduate school theology. And on top of that, we just spend the $50,000 in tax to get up to the line. So praise God. So God is building his house. We are building. Every time we worship, every time we come to church, we're adding that stone to the spiritual circuit. We are collaborating with God in building his house. We are in the midst of God's spiritual circuit. If you read 1 Corinthians chapter 3, what is the idea of Jesus? What tells us? Because the church there in Corinth. They follow Christ, but the means is they follow their church to Christ and don't want anybody else to follow Christ. so there he does, by the way, because judgment. In verse 16 and 17, he says, "Do you not know that you are the temple of God, the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, which temple is you are." Now, we often apply this to the Israelites. Oh, I think next time just get some info. So the story is told of some bricklayers that were working on the cathedral wall. And they jumped up quickly to what he's doing. And they just did a great thing. He went to the next guy and said, "What are you doing?" He goes, "I'm building a wall." He goes, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm building a wall." You're all doing the same work. But one person just saw it. Thank you. someone is taken by Jesus. And that's the greatest of things. When someone tells you about their struggles and they deal with money to survive, and you pray for the next one to come and say, hey, glory to God begins to heal this country. If there's promise for a building that has it, because things are coming and overwhelm us, and we just have to stop and raise our hands, or we just have to stop and fall on our face and say, thank you, Lord, for our power of your peace. Thank you, Lord, that I'm part of your presence. Thank you, Lord, that I'm part of your peace. Thank you for the privilege of that. Would you like to encourage one another? Let's pray for one another. Let's be sensitive to one another.